Okay, good afternoon, students. Today we will going to discuss about the important topic, that is selection, planning and preparation, evaluation of visual aids. See, as we are in an extension, when we are teaching a farmer, we cannot convey all the messages to the farmers through words only. So in that case, these audio visual aids will help us to get complete information about or to convince the farmers about the important technologies to be disseminated to the farming community. So visual aids are any instructional devices that can be seen but not heard. I have been covered this topic before also. What are visual aids, what are audio visual aids and what are audio aids. But visual aids, as the name itself indicates, that we can see it. For effective communication, we need a visual aids. But whenever we are telling about the visual aids, the very important point one should consider while selecting a visual aids is what is right to a particular situation or what is right to a particular technology to be disseminated. And one more thing is you must be familiar with the aid which we are selecting. And it should be based on the needs of a farmer. For example, if the farmers are illiterate, whenever I'm choosing a visual aids, there should not be too much the oral or written communication, rather than it should involve more of photos, pictures, something like that. So it should be based on needs and familiarities. And the next one is, one must know the strength and weakness of any visual aids. Many times what happens, that as an audio communicator, I may not be knowing how to use a visual aid or how I have to use it as an aid in my communication process. In that situation, I must know or evaluate my own strength and weakness, and sometimes the strength and weakness of the visual aids also. For example, the projected aids. If there is no power, how could I use that aid for communication? So all these things to be considered while selection of a right visual aids. And next one is availability whenever it is needed. See, there are many visual aids, but we don't know whether they are available whenever I am needing it. That I don't know. So in that case, one must be able to know that whether that visual aid is available based on the needs of a communicator or the audience. Now we will see what are the different common types of visual aids. The first one is photographs, objects, specimens, models, charts and graphs, maps, posters and exhibits, flannel boards, magnetic boards and chalkboards. All these are coming under visual aids, but some of them are two-dimensional and some of them are three-dimensional. So I have given small things about this. Now we will see one by one. The first one is about the charts. The charts are nothing but it is a combination of graphic and pictorial media designed for the orderly and logically visualizing of relationship between key facts or ideas. See, where in a chart, see, you could able to see the different types of charts which is available here. So here, there may be different charts. Many times we used to tell it as the pictorial charts or the continuous chart or relay charts like that. See, in the next class, I am going to cover different types of charts and graphs in my next class. But these charts will going to represent, or it may consist of a graphic or a pictures, which will going to give us a complete information or visualization of relationship between the different facts which we want to convey to the farmers. There are, the charts are also there. Sometimes we use the graphs in a charts. These graphs are nothing but a visual representation of numerical data. Whenever I want to express about the production of paddy in different talukas of Shivamogga district, I used to use these graphs, because here the my major fact is a numerical data which could be represented very effectively with the help of a graph. The next comes is the map. Map, you know very well, it is the symbolic depiction emphasizing the relationship between elements of some space, such as objects, regions, or themes. See, usually the map will going to indicate you. Here I have taken a map of India where it is going to indicate you the different places and the relationship or the distance between the different places. So all these things will be indicated through a map. It may be a places, or it may be a space, or maybe object or a region or any theme which we are going to select for in our communication process. Next is a model. Model is a three-dimensional visual aid, which is nothing but a imitation of an object which could be recognizable. See, always we used to depict the model in such a way that maybe integrated farming system. This is what the picture I have given here is about the wind energy, how it is used for the irrigation in a farming. That has been depicted in a model form, which is a three-dimensional but actually recognizable image that gives complete idea about how it works. That is what is called as a model. Next comes is the poster. You have seen many posters when you are traveling on the way, or maybe in a roadside, or maybe in your village, all those things. Or sometimes you might have been used these posters for dissemination of many information. A poster is a large notice or a picture that you stick on a wall or a board, often in order to advertise something. Usually you could able to see the posters are sticked on a wall, or it may be hanged, mainly to give information or advertise about something information. Usually in a poster, it is going to include both the textual and graphical elements. That means it contains a picture and also sometimes a wordings also, or some titles also. But many times there is a chance that the poster may be prepared only with the graphical, that means only with the picture which I have given here, the only picture which convey you the message, or sometimes a poster which consists of only the text, only it is covering only text, that means only the wordings. So usually whenever you are designing a poster, it is mainly to create an awareness among the audience about a particular topic. So it should have a eye-catching and informative information. As soon as you see, it must catch your eyes or catch the interest. See, that is how you have to prepare the poster. Next comes is the specimen. The specimen is nothing but you have done it in your BSc Agri degree also, or every in from your, I think, PU days also, you have collected many specimens. The specimen is an object which is incomplete, or which is representative of a group or class of similar object. For example, many times in your degree program, they have told you to collect the insect specimens, or plant disease specimens, weed specimens, forest species specimens. That does not mean that you are bringing whole forest here or whole tree is here, but only the few leaves or leaves which is infested with a particular disease will be collected, and it could be stored for the future. But that represent a particular group. Group may be a diseased specimen, or to a weed, or a insect. That may be the chance. The specimen may be wet specimen or a dry specimen. You are seeing a picture. It is a wet specimen which is stored in a wet condition, and the dry specimen which we used to do it as a herbarium. Okay, that is what is called as a specimen. Next comes is the object. See, whenever I am teaching or presenting something in front of an audience, these objects will help us to visualize what is actually I am talking. See, I have given here the picture of a different object, maybe a tractor, maybe a trailer, maybe a windmill, maybe a tipper, something like that. Whatever I want to say, I can show them some objects, and I can speak in a public, which will help me to convince the audience what it is actually mean. I cannot express some of the objects orally or by my words. At that time, these objects helps me to enhance my presentation in a public so that I can convince the audience. Next comes is the flannel board. As you can see in the picture, the flannel board is nothing but a board which is covered with a flannel fabric. Flannel fabric is nothing but it is like a woolen like fabric which could hold any object, or it can, any object could be stick to that fabric. Usually it is resting on a ASL. ASL means it is a frame. Its primary use is for storytelling. Usually we used to tell the story by sticking many flannel graph on that, which I'm going to cover in the next class, what is flannel graph. And that will be placed on this flannel board. And as you see in the picture, that ABC and 1, 2, 3, 4 flowers, all the everything is sticked on that. Like that, I can stick many things and it will be used as a storyboard for me. And I can tell all the information for the audience. Next comes is the magnetic board. See, you have seen it everywhere. The magnetic board are the one which is made up of ferromagnetic material. And it is painted very well. Many times it is used to be a white board, or many times it may be in other colors. But majority of the time we used to have a magnetic board will be of white. So here we can draw something on the magnetic board by using the suitable pens, or we can also stick some of the materials with in a magnetic board which is having a magnetic property, and we could able to tell the story, or we could able to convince the farmer by showing all those things. Next comes is the chalkboard. See, chalkboard, you know, every time in your class we used to use the chalkboard. It is reusable writing surface on which text or drawings are made with chalk. It is originally made up of smooth thin sheet of black or dark gray slate stone. Usually the chalkboard will be having a slate stone on which, by using a chalk piece, we are writing maybe a picture, maybe a words or something, which is acting as an aid for us to convince a audience about particular information. So this is also one of the visual media. So these are the major types of visual media. Now we will see what are the important characteristics of a good visual media. So we are telling about a visual media, but it must have certain characteristics. The first one is the suitability. Whenever I am preparing a visual aid, I must see that whether it is suitable for my communication process, or for the audience, or for the objective of the communication. See, if my objective of the communication is to create an awareness among the farming community, then the visual media I am using is the poster. So the important factor you have to consider is the suitability for a particular communication process. And the next comes is the simplicity. Don't make your visual aid very complicated such that it is going to confuse your audience. Always you have to present your visual aid in a simple way such that they could be able to understand in a one sight. And as soon as they see the visual aids, they could get a complete information about it. And the next one is the accuracy. Whatever the information you are giving to the audience through your visual aids, it must be accurate. Don't write the things which is haphazard, or which is not having an authentic source, so which is not having an proven technology. Don't give the things which is not at all acceptable. So always give the information which is very accurate. And next comes is the attractive. See, your visual aid should be attractive. As I told previously also, whenever you are preparing a visual aid, as the name itself indicates that, visual aids must be eye-catcher. It should retain the interest, sustain the interest. So to make this, it should be attractive. And the next one is the necessity. See, I have told you that there are several visual aids. That does not mean that in your communication process, you must use the visual aid in all the communication process. There may be a chance that you can communicate with the people without the visual aids also. So whenever you are preparing a visual aids, you should see that whether it is necessary, and if it is necessary, which type of visual aids I have to choose. So all these five characteristics is very, very essential when you are preparing a good visual aid. So we used to tell that the people will remember about 10% of what they hear, 20% of what they read, and 80% of what they see. So usually we can say that the nearly more than 80%, sometimes we used to say based on our research findings that the people can remember nearly about 80% of what they see. And we can say that 83% of learning will take place through eyes. Whatever we learn is by our visuals. not only by the oral means. So that's why we should know how important is the visual aids in a communication process, because my communication process will be meaningful when I am going to use a suitable visual aid which could able to help me in getting the proper understanding of the message which a communicator want to convey. So the technology could be effectively and very efficiently conveyed to the ultimate user through these visual aids. Now we will see the effective teaching aid should have certain principles. These principles, in short, we'll call it as a ABCD, ABC principle. The first one is A. A is nothing but the attractiveness. See, whatever the visual aid we are preparing must be attractive. The attractive does not mean that it should look smart. It is nothing but the attractiveness is expressed in terms of their colors we are using, the size, shape, and how we are illustrating the information in our visual aid will going to decide about the attractiveness. Here I have given two posters which is prepared mainly for that. See how attractive. The colors used are only 2 to 3, only few sentences with 1 or 2 pictures. So this makes us the immediate eye-catching, and we will going to convey, it is conveying us the what is important and what has to be taken from this posters. Next principle is B. The B is nothing but brevity. That means whatever the message you want to give in your visual aid should be brief enough. That is brief. Why? Because it could be easily read in a short period of time. Visual aids means our eye will sustain there for some time and it will be having a some period of time in that. So the visual aids should be visualized in a short period of time. I cannot give too much time. For example, in a road, you might have been saw the posters or banners like that. So while passing, you used to see it. But at that time, you cannot have a time to stand there only and read everything. Maybe in an exhibition, maybe in a Krishi Mela or Mela something. So where you cannot stand and read each and everything. So it must be very brief, such brief in such a way that they should read in a short period of time. For example, I have given here the 3 visual aids, which is having only few words, but it is conveying the full meaning, which could be read in a short period of time. For example, say water, the word is in your hands. The picture is also suitable to the title which is given to that posters. And by using our collective strength, we achieve more. So you can see the picture and it is only a few words which is there in a poster, which could be read and understand in a short period of time because the message is very brief. The third principle is C. So in out of ABC, the C is the third principle. That does not mean that the clarity. Whatever the information you are giving in your poster must be clear. That is, idea of the message should be very clear, and it should be very clear about it. For example, I have given here, the whenever you are giving a message, it should be clear to the picture which you have given, or clear to the situation for which you have selected your poster or the ideas. Next comes the layout and design of the visual materials. Whenever you are designing a visual material, it must have a certain the principles to lay out all those things. The first thing is you must arrange or display the teaching material within a given space. So it should not mean that I have prepared a big 40 by 40 feet visual aid. That does not mean that I cannot accommodate in a given space. See, one must think that whether I can accommodate, I can carry it and I can place it in a class. Based on that, I have to prepare my visual aid and layout should be such that. And one must give a safe margin. See, whenever you are preparing, you must give a margin. See, students, you are always having this bad habit that you never leave a margin. But whenever you are writing any aid, you must give a margin around the edges, means all the 4 sides, you must give a safe margin. And the next comes is, we must give the importance or importance for the captions. What is the title of my visual aids? That should be what type of text I am using, and that should be very important, because as soon as I see a visual aid, the first my concentration will go to the captions. And always, whatever the text or the information or what you want to convey to the audience should be placed inside the margin or whatever the safety margin I have given in my visual aids around the edges of a visual aid. And the primary objective of layout is to draw the attention of the audience or the viewers. So always I must place the which is the important material or important information which I want to convey to the audience should be at the center of interest. As soon as they see, the eye must go there and they must get a complete information about it. And the last important things you have to remember while designing is the overall layout must be balanced in a relation to its size, color, contrast which you are giving to the visual to emphasize where it has to be emphasized. See, for example, I am having only one A4 size sheet. I cannot rush everything inside it. So I have to balance it in terms of the size available for me. What are the colors I am using there, and the contrast. Contrast we are giving mainly to give an emphasis. That has to be considered. Now I am telling you about the two types of layout. One is the formal layout, another one is the informal layout. Whereas the formal layout, you could able to see that everything is clearly arranged. See, everything has been centrally arranged, everywhere it is balanced. See, here also it is linely, correctly arranged. Whereas the informal balance, the informal balance is the one where we are going to use it according to the requirement of the things which we want to check. For example, see here, then the formal balance, I have told that I have marked the center point and everything will be arranged around it. Whereas in an informal balance, based upon that layout, I will going to make it in a different order, but I am not going to rush everything inside it. I am going to use only the required number of pictures, color, everything. And always I have told you that you have to place the picture which is off to be very interesting and should be at the center. There are two types of center in a poster. One is the physical center, another one is the optical center. Optical center is very, very essential whenever I am going to put the important visual in my visual aids or important point in my visual aid. Always keep the important point in an optical center rather than a physical center, because it will be always going to be acting as an eye catcher. And whenever I am telling about the layout, it is consisting of the five important points. The first one is the caption, lettering, illustration, color, and the fifth one is the balance. Now we will see one by one. The first one is the caption. See, whenever we are writing a caption, the caption must be clear. Clear means always the message or idea which I want to convey to the farmers or the audience through my visual aids should be very clear. The caption itself should not be a complex that nobody will go through that visual aids. So it should be clear. As I told, it should be brief. It should be easy to read in a short span of time or at a stretch. They must, it one side, they should read the caption. Next is the understandable. The message which we want to give through this visual aid should be in a simple language or in a colloquial language if I am conveying to the farmers, based on the knowledge and attitude level of the knowledge level of the farmers, I have to give the caption. And the caption should be in such a way that it should be able to give the farmer the complete knowledge and helps in changing the attitude of the farmers. And always the caption should be catchy. The caption should be catchy to the reader so that they can go through it and they should remember for a long. For example, I have read so many articles. In some of the articles, the captions are very interesting. That made me to read the entire article, and that made me to remember that article and even the caption also. I have read one article on child labor. The caption was, "The flower without a petal was a flower." That does not mean that the children are like a flower, but they are used for a labor. So there is no petal to show the beauty. But even though they are the flower, because they are the children. Like that, the caption should be very catchy. As soon as we read, it should catch our interest and should be remembered for a long period of time. Relevant. My caption should be relevant to the subject which I am reading or writing, or the visuals I am using for my communication process. It should be very much relevant. See, for example, I have given here, the caption should be for an article, or caption should be for the picture. But whenever you are giving a caption, that should be relevant to the pictures or the communication process which I am planning and which I am presenting in front of the audience. Now, the next comes is the lettering principle. The lettering means it is the effectiveness of a visual aids could be enhanced by using your letters. What type of letters you are going to use will going to enhance the effectiveness of the visual aid. See, every visual material requires a lettering. That does not mean that a visual aid cannot be presented with the picture, but it could be presented with the picture, but the picture must have a title. For that title, we must use a letter, or at least for a caption, we must use a letter. So whenever we are using a lettering, it should be emphasized, and it should explain, clarify, and it should reinforce the ideas of an audience. Usually, there are different types of lettering. The five major types of lettering are, first one is hand lettering, which I have given here. This is a hand lettering. That is nothing but how we usually used to write in through our hands. Maybe cursive letter. We used to tell it as a cursive letter. Next comes is the cutout lettering. Cutout lettering is nothing but we are going to cut the letters from different sources, and we are going to stick it on a sheet, and it will be looking like a cutout lettering. Then the next comes is the stencil lettering. You know that there is a stencil, and that could be used to write ABCD up to 10 also. And these stencils are used to write the title, or it should be used as a source of lettering. Next is the felt lettering. Felt lettering means where you are embossing the letters. When you touch a letter, you could able to feel that there is a felt lettering. And the next lettering is a transfer lettering. That is nothing but we are transferring a lettering from some stickers with the help of a stickers, or we are going to transfer it by printing in somewhere and transferring from there to a next visual aids. And the next important is the ideal writing, how it should be. The important aspect we must cover when in a writing in a visual aid. The first is the height of a letter. Whenever we are preparing a visual aid, the height of a letter is very, very important. This height of a letter is mainly related with the number of learners in a communication process and the distance with which they are sitting from a visual aid. Usually distance is measured with the person who is sitting in a last row. If I am teaching in a class, my visual aid is in at the board, then the size of a letter is mainly depends upon the student, the distance between the board and the student who is sitting in the last bench. So this size of a letter is used in the preparation of visual aids. For example, if the furthest viewer distance is 8 feet, then the minimum height of a letter is 0.25 inch. If it is 16 feet, then it is a 0.5 inch. If it is 32 feet, it is 1 inch. And if it is 64 feet, it is 2 inch. This distance and the height of the letter is decided based on many experiments conducted by the scientist. And the next point which is considered for the ideal writing is arrangements. How you are going to arrange the letters is going to decide about the efficiency of your visual aids. See, arrangement is mainly depends upon your layout or the design. The placement of the letter in a horizontal way is mainly better than the vertical. See, here I have given the arrangement which is presented in a horizontal is easy. It is very easy to read compared to the vertical presentation. It is very cumbersome and difficult to read and difficult to understand, mainly because of our horizontal optical observation. And the third one is the thickness of the letter. Whenever you are preparing a visual aids, the thickness of the letter is also very, very important. The thickness of the letter is related with the height. If the height is always, the thickness of the letter should be the 1/5 of the height of the letter is considered. For example, if the height of the letter is 5 cm, then the thickness of the letter should be 1 cm. And the fifth point, next is the capitals. See, whenever you are preparing a visual aids, it is advised that always use for the captions are important points which you want to present, always use the capital letters. For example, you see here how the impact of a capital letter and what will be the impact of a small letter. So whenever you want to present some information through your visual aids, always you should use a capital rather than a small letter. And the next comes is the shape. Usually, whenever we are preparing a visual aids, the letters or the captions or the content which you want to present in a visual aids, you must use the usual lettering rather than the unusual lettering. We used to get the different letters with unusual shapes. For example, I have given here, if you are going to present your letters in an unusual form, it is very difficult to understand and it will take a long period to understand what is A, what is B, what is C and all those things. Always you should present the information in a usual shapes of a letter rather than unusual shapes. And the sixth one is the style. There are different style of lettering, but usually most important style of lettering which is accepted in preparation of a visual aids are, the first one is Gothic style. See, which I have given here, which is easy to understand. And the next one is writing style. As we are always using the writing style, easy method, easily observable and easy to accept it. And the next one is the Roman style. And the last one is the italic style. These are the four major type of styling of the letter, which is usually accepted whenever you are preparing a visual aids. The seventh one is the spacing. That is the spacing which we are giving between the letters, between the words and between the lines. If you are following a proper spacing between the words, letter and the lines, which will going to improve the readability of that information and also the attraction of the letter will also going to increase. Whenever we are telling about the spacing between the letter, there are two types of spacing between the letter. The first one is the mechanical spacing. Next one is the optical spacing. The mechanical spacing means it will be uniform spacing only. Optical spacing is based upon our eyesight. We used to write the letters with the spacing between the letters. Some may be more, some may be less. Based upon the style of the letter, we used to give the spacing. And the next one is the spacing between the words. Usually, the spacing between the words we used to follow a O letter or a zero letter, O letter size has to be given. But when we were studying in a school, our teacher used to tell that you should give a one finger spacing or a two finger spacing based on that. So like that, whenever you are writing a word, you have to leave a one finger spacing or you have to leave a space of O letter. And spacing between the lines should be half of the height of a capital letter in the upper line. See, whenever we are writing, so always the spacing between the lines should be, if the capital letter is of 2 cm height, then the spacing between the lines should be 0.5 cm. See, this is what you have to follow. And whenever we are giving a spacing between the letters, there may be an auto spacing will be there. Usually we used to do. When there is a spaceless, the tight spacing means everything will be very high, very close to each other letters. And the next one is the loose spacing. That is, we are giving more spacing required than the required. Usually we are recommended to give optical spacing between the letters rather than these tight, loose, or equal spacing or mechanical spacing. Next comes is the important, whenever we are telling about visuals, the color are very, very important. That is the coloring technique. Color is very important because it adds attraction to the visuals, but the attraction is mainly depends upon how properly we are using a color with a which must have a definite impact on the viewers. There are different kinds of colors. The first one is the primary colors. The primary colors are the one which could not be obtained by mixing two or more colors. That they are red, yellow, and blue. They are also called as the pure colors. And the next one is the secondary or complementary colors. These are obtained after mixing a two primary colors. The complementary color or the secondary color will come. For example, by mixing red and yellow, we used to get a orange. By mixing blue and yellow, we are getting green. By mixing blue and red, we are getting violet or the purple. And the third type of color is the contrasting color. See, contrasting color is also known as sometimes the complementary colors. See, when it is applied side by side, I have given you here a color wheel. You could able to see. For example, the blue, the different types of blue are there. Blue, green, blue, blue, violet, violet, red, violet, red. That means apart from this also, in between blue also, we are getting so many contrast colors. So when these contrast colors are applied side by side, it will going to give us a sharp effect. That means it will going to give us a prominent. For example, I have taken a white background with the yellow box are the blue letters. So that is what the contrast color. These contrast colors will help us to give a prominence. But one must take a care that the quality of one complementary color or the contrast color should not be much or less than the other complementary colors or vice versa. That means whenever we are presenting, we must use in such a way that it should be visuality should be good. Impact should be good. It should not be both dark, both light. It should not be there. It should be of contrast. So whenever we are telling about the coloring technique, we use each color is conveying the different meaning for us. For example, if it is a black, it says that it is a formal, neat, rich, and a strong. When we are telling about a blue, blue is nothing but a cool, depressed, quiet. So next purple comes the royalty, rich and the strong. Red, always love, anger, stimulating, bright. Orange is a festive and gay. And yellow, it is a warmth, joy and cheerfulness. Whereas green, always we used to tell it as a fresh, growing and young. White, it is giving us the meaning of a purity, neatness or a cleanness. Like that, whenever we are using a color, each color is giving us a meaning to us. So always use a bright color to attract the attention to a major point. Whenever I want to convey some important points, you must have a light background with the dark or a bright color letters that will going to attract the attention to that particular point. And always it is suggested to use a contrasting color, as I told already. And always you have to use the shade of a same color to suggest minor changes. There is some changes, we must use a shade of a color. And whenever I am telling about the color combination or the relationship, we must, if you are having a particular background, the symbols or the letters should be used is, should be choosed like that. If it is a white background, you must choose red, green, blue, brown, or a violet. If it is a yellow background, then you can choose red, blue, black, brown, and green. If it is blue, light blue, then go for yellow, black, brown, violet, and dark blue. And it is a dark green, you can go for yellow and white. If it is pink, green, black, and dark blue. If it is red, you can go for green, white, and yellow. Dark brown, then you can go for orange, light green, white, and yellow. If it is light brown, you can choose blue, red, black, and dark gray. If it is light gray, go for blue, black, green, and red. If it is black, you can choose red, white, light, blue, silver, green. And if it is blue, it is red, white, silver, and green. And if it is light green, you can choose red, brown, and black. So these are the important backgrounds. And based on these background, you can choose a different symbols. And the last one is the orange. If it is your background is the orange, you can choose the white, black. So students, these are the some of the basic information I want to give you before you go for actual preparation of visual aids, which should be used for effective communication and convincing the farmers about a particular technology in my communication process. Thank you.